My name is John Zhang, and I'm the chair of this session. Here we have four talks. The first one is More Efficient Universal SQL Constructions by Daniel Ganser, Agnes Keys, Thomas Slater, and Agnes will give us a talk.
Thank you very much for the introduction. So my name is Agnes, as mentioned, and we are from TU Darmstadt. This is joint work with Daniel Günther, who is sitting here, and my advisor, Thomas Schneider. I'm going to talk about more efficient universal circuit constructions and the way we took another step on this theory, theory practice line forward. So universal circuits were proposed by Leslie Valiant in 1976. The definition, so how he defined it, is that there exists a Boolean circuit that has size order of n log n, for which it holds that any Boolean function of at most size n, the UC can be made to compute. So we can compute any functionality with this universal circuit. So what does it mean that we can make it compute the functionality? It means that there exists a set of programming bits such that we can input these programming bits into the circuit as an additional input, and it will compute our functionality on the original input, as shown in the figure. Applications of universal circuits. There are a couple of more theoretical applications where it's used in some protocols to make it more generic or more universal. It can be used for obfuscation or in some attribute-based encryption protocols. It can also be used for batch execution secure computation when we actually want to compute multiple functionalities faster. And it can be that if we want to compute it many, many times, then with batch execution secure computation of universal circuits, we are going to be more efficient. The most prominent application is private function evaluation, and I would like to go a little bit into detail about this. So first of all, we are in the secure multi-party computation session. So what is actually secure function evaluation, or secure computation, or in my case, secure two-party computation? We have Alice on one side and Bob on the other, and they would like to get to know who of them is Richard. This is the famous millionaire's problem. And there exist interactive protocols with which they can do it without the use of a trusted third party. Some of these protocols use Boolean circuits, and the two most famous ones are the Gauss-Gabbert circuit protocol and the GMW protocol. And private function evaluation extends this notion a little bit. So now on one hand, we have Bob, who became an insurance, like the employee of an insurance company, and Alice would like to buy a car. So she also would want to know if Bob's insurance company gives her insurance for this car or not. So Bob would like to check if Alice is eligible, is like, if he can give insurance to her or not. So Alice provides all her sensitive information for this, and Bob provides this functionality, which is to be also kept private, since the insurance company does not want to reveal it to Alice. And then we want some protocol like this, and this is called private function evaluation, that is similar to secure computation, but it also hides the function on one side. Okay, how can we do this? First of all, Bob should represent this functionality as a Boolean circuit. And then we can just use universal circuit and secure computation to compute this, because the universal circuit is a big entity for which we only need to reveal the maximum size of Bob's functionality, and then we can use it with the two inputs. So Bob now represents his functionality as a data, and then he can just input it into the universal circuit, and then we can get the result using secure computation, securely. So what do we expect from a universal circuit construction in general? We expect that for an input circuit C, which has size n, which is the sum of its inputs, outputs, and gates, it gives us two things. First of all, it gives us the universal circuit itself, which can be generated by anyone, this is only dependent on the size of the circuit. And it also gives us the programming bit, which actually depends on the input circuit. So this is the only part that depends on the input circuit. Okay, so where are we when it comes to universal circuit constructions right now? So as I mentioned, Valiant was the first to give the idea and prove the existence of such universal circuits, and he has given two constructions already in 1976. Both are recursive constructions, and they are based on, so one of them is based on a two-way recursive structure, so when we use two substructures within the structure, and the other one on a four-way structure. And this means, so the two-way construction has a slightly larger size than the four-way construction, but it has a better depth. So in some scenarios, maybe we would want to use that. But in general, we like to optimize for the size. So the four-way construction is a little bit better. Then for 32 years, there was silence when it comes to UC research. And in 2008, Kolesnikov and Schneider proposed another universal circuit construction, which also they have been implemented. They have implemented, and this has an asymptotically larger size and also depth, unfortunately, but this was the first universal circuit construction that has been brought to practice. Then in, so last year, two concurrent and independent works have studied Valiant's two-way UC construction and managed to bring it into practice. So we were one of the works. It was published in Eurocrypt 2016, and we looked into the actual programming protocol of Valiant's two-way construction and brought it into practice. Our code is also available for this construction. And then also the other work from Lipma, Mohasek, and Zadakian proposed the generalization of Valiant's construction to a K-way construction, so we can now have any number of recursion, so the recursive like the structure can use any number of substructures within. Then in this work, we first of all look into bringing the four-way split construction into practice. And second of all, we also provide a hybrid construction, which will achieve a slightly better concrete size than that of Valiant's four-way construction, but asymptotically it will have the same size and depth. Okay, so Valiant's UC construction in a very brief manner. So we have the circuit, the input circuit, which has at most size n, and we can generate its graph at the first step. So this means that for every input, output, and gate, we generate a node. So there exists a node, and for every buyer between them, we have an edge. This is quite intuitive, and we will call this the graph of the circuit. Then we can generate, given n, a so-called universal graph. And then we need to embed the graph of the circuit into this universal graph. Now I want to tell you what embedding actually means in this sense. So we have a universal graph, and the property of this graph is that you can have any combination, so you can go from any special nodes to any other special nodes in this graph, and you can have any combination that is valid in this graph of the circuit. And the embedding means that we want to find disjoint paths within this universal graph for every single node, every single edge in the original graph. So this is a small example for what embedding means. So we can see that this is the path we found for this edge. This is another path we found for this other dead edge. Okay, so after this, we can just output the universal circuit and the programming bits as well. So the programming bits depend on this embedding. So our contributions, the first one is looking into the programming algorithm of the four-way construction and making it a little bit more modular, so it can we can then bring it into practice. So the modular, so the construction itself, as I mentioned, has a four-way recursive structure. This means that we have an internal skeleton which is then created for n nodes, and then we create for smaller skeletons for n over 4 nodes. And this skeleton consists of many blocks that repeat, so that are repetitive. And then these nodes, so these blocks look like the one on the left, on the right side, left side for you. And they have some special nodes on top and on the bottom. We will call them input and output nodes in this case. And then they have special nodes in between, the green ones, and they are the ones that correspond to the original graph of the circuit, actually. And what happens is that we want to, so the structure enables any single input node to go into any special node, and from any special node we can also go into any of the output nodes. And this will help us later. And this, so this task of going from any, so from the particular nodes we need to go to the special nodes, and from the special nodes to the output nodes, is called block embedding. And this is the first task. This is the easier one, because we are dealing with only small blocks. And then these, so this skeleton itself is interconnected with the sub structures through these input and output nodes, basically. So we have one interconnection to every single smaller subgraph, and they are not interconnected with each other. So the smaller graphs are totally independent of each other. And so the other task we have is to define what programming needs to be done in the blocks. So what do we actually want to lead where, and where from do we want to lead what within the blocks? That's the first task. And the second task is to give information to all these recursion points as well, in order to be able to go one step further down. So this is basically the recursion point embedding, we call it. So just a very brief idea of how we actually do this recursion point embedding. We already know from the two-way split construction, so from the programming of the two-way split construction, that we can generate a tree for the graph itself, so the graph of the circuit itself, which it corresponds to the universal graph. And this we generate by merging every two neighbors at every step. So this is how we get smaller graphs. And then we split them in two with some coloring algorithm, so that we have graphs with the same property as before. So we have a graph here with a certain property, and then we split it, and then we merge it again, and then we split it again, and so on and so forth. Okay, so this was used, so when we looked at where a certain edge goes within this path, so we have an edge in the original graph, and then it goes in a way in the smaller graphs as well. And this defined how we actually, so which subgraphs we need to use in the universal graph itself. So now in the four-way split construction, we can use every second graph that was generated before. So we don't need to find a new algorithm. We can just take the previous embedding, like the defining of the embedding, and then skip every second step, and then we can find these four graphs at each step. We need a small trick, a small modification, but I don't go into details about that. Okay. Then we looked into the size of the UCs and proposed a new hybrid method. So Lipma et al. In the last year had shown that there exist these K-way constructions, and we can actually have any K for the UC, for Valiant UC. And we looked into the actual asymptotic complexities that we would get. And we have seen that the best is actually the four-way and the two-way split construction, what Valiant has already proposed, so we cannot find anything better. First, it seemed that the three-way construction will be actually better, but unfortunately, There was a small trick that Valiant has used for one of the building blocks that he used before somewhere, and that same trick didn't apply in our case, and we have to have another node which makes it actually bigger than the two-way and the four-way space constructions. Okay, so then we looked into the concrete sizes. So just to give a few examples, so this is for a circuit that has at most size around 40,000. It can also evaluate AES. It would have around 2.4 million NTAs in the resulting universal circuit. And it is usually better with a four-way construction, but sometimes for small circuit instances, it is better with a two-way split construction. So then we looked into so what's the difference between the two-way and the four-way split construction. On the x-axis, we have the two-way split construction, that's 0% improvement over two-way split, and then this fluctuating thing is the improvement of the four-way split you see over the two-way split you see. So we can see that for small circuits, actually, most of the times, the two-way split construction performs better. So then we thought, okay, but we need a lot of these small UCs within the big UC, right? So we have, in the end, a lot of these. Usually when we want to have big circuits, we have a lot of smaller circuits inside. So why aren't we doing something smarter? Why aren't we combining the two so that we can get better concrete complexities? So then we decided, okay, we create a dynamic programming algorithm and see at every single step, is it better to create four skeletons for the four-way split, or is it better to create two skeletons for the two-way split? And whichever is better, we go for that one at each step. And this actually results in a nicer graph in the end. So the green line is now the improvement of the hybrid UC over the two-way split UC. And this fluctuates in the beginning as well, but it's always at least zero. And then it becomes much more consistent by the end, and it will stay always around 3.64% improvement over the two-way split construction. Okay. And basically, so this fluctuation is due to the parity and the modulo 4 properties of the size of the circuit, actually. So just to give an intuition, might not be clear yet, but if you are interested, come to me afterwards. So the concrete sizes also become better in every example that we have. Then we also implemented this universal circuit construction, so we verified that we really do it correctly. So the implementation uses the first step from the existing UC implementation from 2016. And so we generate the graph of the circuit based on the input circuit, as I mentioned before. And then for the size of the circuit, we generate a universal graph, which now looks very different. So it's now a four-way construction and not a two-way construction. And then we embed this graph of the circuit into the universal graph and output the UC and the programming. And this we call a four-way UC compiler. And I have some good news here. We have code. So you can go and you can find it open source online. And if you want, you can play around with it. You can ask questions later, come to us if there's something that you are interested in implementing or using this for. Some experimental results. So it does take some seconds to compute the universal circuits for fairly large input circuits. However, we can see that, so for example, for an AES circuit, it would take around 7 seconds with the faster construction and 8 with the four-way split construction. And for a very large circuit like SHA-256, so with 200,000 gates, we would get around a minute runtime. However, this is only pre-computation time when it comes to private function evaluation. So we never So this is only done on the side of the function holder. Only he needs to do it, and he can pre-compute it. He doesn't need to even know Alice at the moment when he computes this this universal circuit. And we see that actually we get better runtimes when we go to larger and larger circuits, and that's due to the fact that the universal circuit will also be smaller, so we have less programming when we go upwards. So one last comparison. So there exist special purpose protocols for private function evaluation. They are solely based on oblivious transfers, and they have better computation complexity, so they have a smaller number of symmetric key operations. The public key operations are the same. They depend only on the security parameter, but they have a better number of symmetric key operation. So this particular protocol we compared to was proposed by Mohassan and Sadeghian 4 years ago. And so this is logarithmic scale, so the improvement is only based on a constant factor before the n log n. And then we have, so we looked into the communication of the protocols, and actually we've seen that we have better communication. And that's due to the fact that not every optimization and improvement for secure computation actually applies directly to the other protocols, but it applies directly to our protocols, so we can get better communication complexities than them. So there was one work this year that improved over the Mohassan Sadeghian work, which then included one of the optimizations that exists in secure computation for private function evaluations. Okay, so our contributions were, we actually looked into the algorithm for embedding the graph into the four-way split construction, then looked into the size of the circuit and proposed a new hybrid method, and then implemented it and have a new UC compiler. So we have taken some step forwards, mainly towards practice, and so thank you very much for your attention, and if you have any questions, I'm very happy to answer them.
All comments?
Yeah. Can you go back to the slide where you're talking about hybrid, the universal circuit, yeah, the performance? Yeah. Go formula one or two to say the performance. Yeah, so can you explain why the light green area comes from, like from the previous slide, you are trying to combine, trying to use either two-way or four-way, but where does the benefit of the green part come from?
So the green line, yeah, is actually, yeah, the improvement of the hybrid over the two-way split construction, no, over the four-way split construction, you're right. Yeah, so okay. It's actually not, so the whole graph would show the improvement over the two-way split, but if, since I didn't color the parts that are below the blue, but not, but above the red line, it is actually, so the green colored parts show the improvement of the hybrid over the four-way split construction.
So because of the time, we have a lot of time for more questions. Let's thank the speaker again.